On July 14th, 2015, I woke up at 4:45 a.m. I fed and watered myself, put on my Tuesday best, and climbed into a car I'd rented the day before. All of this, of course, was in the name of Pluto. As a bit of a space nerd, and I might be under-exaggerating with a bit, I'm used to reading articles about the latest science news. That being said, when I was given a press pass for the NASA New Horizons Pluto flyby, say that three times fast, I wanted to take an opportunity to show you something few people get to see, what it's like to be a science journalist at a huge space event. But first, a quick recap of the science you might have missed. In 2006, NASA launched a space probe called New Horizons toward Pluto. On July 14th, 2015, after 9 years and 3 billion miles, New Horizons made its closest approach to the Pluto system, and we observed the planet and its moons up close for the first time. This is a big deal. Anyway, New Horizons was built by a team at the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory, or APL. On the 14th, almost all of the big names and people who worked on the project were at APL, as well as a ton of media. Anyway, after geeking out over my media badge, I successfully found a spot in the main hall among scientists from NASA, APL, and Southwest Research Institute, their families, and people with much more impressive cameras than I. Leading up to the flyby, there were amazing speeches by people like Dr. Alan Stern, the principal investigator for New Horizons, the president of APL, and even the children of Clyde Tombaugh, the astronomer who discovered Pluto in 1930. But at long last, after 9 years of science and many more of planning, at 7:49 a.m., New Horizons flew past Pluto. I am so proud of our space program. When the moment was over, though, what's a science journalist to do? Well, meet Bill Nye, for one. It's not a secret that I aspire to be the quote-unquote Lady Bill Nye of my generation. I want to combine my love for science and video to make people realize that it's just worth it, no matter how painful classes may be. Science is just inherently optimistic and challenging and the closest thing we have to magic and, oh, right. Anyway, so I took a selfie with Bill Nye, and he was incredibly gracious. I then proceeded to text every single member of my family. After the flyby, there was a barrage of media events, some private and others broadcast on NASA TV, that we had the option to attend. Private events, like individual interviews with scientists, mostly consisted of a lot of journalists sitting in a room and typing furiously on their laptops. Press conferences also consisted mostly of more journalists sitting in a larger room typing furiously on their laptops. If there were no interviews or press conferences, or if you happened to be a member of a film or television crew, you could probably be found sitting in a classroom soaking up the Wi-Fi and video editing. Overall, though, I was thoroughly impressed with the inquisitive nature and quick thinking of all the journalists at APL. As someone still learning how to be a science writer, it was a great lesson for me, but something I think many people may not realize. Not only do you have to listen attentively enough to understand what the scientist is talking about, and listen attentively for hours, for the record, but you have to be curious enough to ask follow-up questions. It's not like a lecture where you can sit back and daydream between bullet points. This is actual learning and exploring and questioning so you can showcase something amazing to the public. What an incredible job. I hope I can be at least half the writer someday that some of these people are. While most of the New Horizons data won't come back to Earth until July 15th, the probe was set to ping home the night of the 14th just to let everyone know it was doing okay. After that come 16 months of brand new, absolutely incredible, never-before-seen data on Pluto and its moons, and that's pretty amazing. After New Horizons is done with the Pluto system, it will continue on into the Kuiper Belt, the icy region of the solar system beyond the gas giants, where it will send back data for up to 20 years before it becomes too cold to live. After that, it and the ashes of Clyde Tombaugh that it carries will drift through deep space for just about forever. So, after sitting in on several personal interviews, a couple of amazing group panels, meeting Bill Nye, networking with some incredible journalists, and witnessing history, where did that leave me?
Ugh. I am honestly baffled, amazed, and dumbfounded at how this day went. I couldn't have asked for it to go any better, and I'm incredibly thankful for the team at New Horizons and Johns Hopkins APL for letting me come out for the day and see what it's like behind the scenes of a huge scientific event. All right, I'm gonna try and drive back into Washington, D.C. now. wish me luck, and if I get this video edited, well, you'll know I made it home alive.
I don't know if I've ever been so happy to be a pedestrian.